Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. Then first and foremost, my brothers and sisters, that I'd like to thank the brothers and sisters who have taken their time out to organize this event today here in Oxford. That may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place it in their scales of good deeds on Yawm al-Qiyamah, so it may be a source for them to attain the forgiveness and the mercy of Allah and entry into Jannah. The topic is connected to the issue of tasfiyah and tarbiyah and the revival or the giving strength back to the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to revive it and to take it out of the dark times that the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam finds itself in. And this discussion really begins with the obligation and knowing and the obligatory nature of every single individual knowing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them for. When a person understands and realizes that indeed Allah Jalla wa Ala has created them for a particular purpose, understanding that purpose and then moving on and implementing that purpose and carrying it to their families, to their children, to their neighbors, to their relatives, then that is the greatest and the first and the greatest of all steps in implementing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them for. Just as Allah has stated in His book, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, I did not create the jinn nor the mankind except that they should worship me alone. So the very purpose of our creation, the purpose why we are here upon this earth, for which Allah created Adam and Allah created the creation, was to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and to abandon and to remove themselves and to quit the worship of anything else. So that's the purpose of our creation. The reason why the Ummah is in the difficulty that it is in today is because some of these realities, meaning the obligation of worshipping Allah alone and fulfilling that greatest of all fundamentals, and thereafter, of course, that every single prophet and messenger that he came, that prophet and messenger was obligated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call his people to the worship of Allah, and the people were obligated to worship Allah in the manner that prophet would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning that the first thing that a person recognizes is that yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did create us to worship Him. But the knowledge of that, of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be worshipped, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave it to your intellects, nor to your desires, nor to how you feel that you wish to worship Allah. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent prophets and messengers to mankind to inform them of the manner in which Allah is to be worshipped. When mankind deviated from that worship of Allah and committed sins and crimes, and they became negligent and they became lazy and they became inattentive, and they deviated to other means of worship or other objects of worship, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them messengers. Those messengers would remind them and obligate them and give them glad tidings that if they were to worship Allah, Allah would put them into Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent those messengers also to warn them that if they do not worship Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would punish them with the hellfire. وَلَقَدْ بَأَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ, that we did not send except a messenger to every single nation, calling them to the worship of Allah and away from the worship of the false deities, of the طاغوت. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligated upon mankind that they listen to those prophets and messengers. And from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that Allah sent those prophets and messengers to every single nation. In a hadith of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah Allah's Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that indeed Allah sent 124,000 prophets and 313 and odd messengers, all of them with that same singular priority of calling the people to the worship of Allah. So they were obligated to worship Allah. When they deviated, when they worshipped Allah, then Allah would send down upon them blessings and bounties. When they deviated from the worship of Allah, then Allah would remove those bounties away from them, and Allah would punish them and send down upon them humiliation. And this is why Allah has stated in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change that which He has, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change that which He has bestowed upon the people up until they change that which is within themselves. Meaning that the goodness that Allah gives to a group of people, because of the fact that they worship Allah and they follow their respective messenger, that Allah will not remove that bounty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not remove that goodness and that glory and that honor that Allah gives them up until they themselves change that which is within themselves. Meaning, when they become wicked and when they become evil, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down upon them calamity after calamity. Just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned with regard to that which took place after at the Battle of Uhud. As you know, at the Battle of Uhud, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he took the battle out to the mushrikeen on the outskirts of Medina to Uhud. Upon the advice and upon consultation with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, he took the battle out to the mushrikeen. So then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed a group of archers on the side of the mountain of Uhud, or a small hillock that is on the side of the mountain of Uhud. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed a group of archers there. And he informed them, regardless of what takes place, whether you see that we, meaning the main body of the Muslims and the main battle that is taking place on the ground below the hillock, even if you see that we are victorious and that we are overpowering the mushrikeen, the idol worshippers, or whether you see that we are being defeated, that they are overpowering us, do not move from your position. Because Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed them there so that if the Muslims are flanked from one side from the enemy, then those archers would take care of them. So they stood there, those archers, and they remained in their position up until the Muslims, when the battle began, and the Muslims began to overpower the mushrikeen in that battle, the Battle of Uhud. And so much so that some of the mushrikeen, some of the bands and some of the army of the mushrikeen began to turn upon their heels and they fled. And the mushrikeen, they had brought their women folk with them. The idol worshippers brought their women folk with them. Because when the mushrikeen debated as to whether to go out and fight at the Battle of Uhud, meaning go to Medina and go and wipe out Islam in Medina, go and kill the Messenger of Allah, go and kill the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they debated amongst each other what would encourage them and what would cause them to remain steadfast against the army of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because they knew that when we attack Muhammad and the army of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that of course they would defend Medina because their women and their children are in Medina, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that they had already been exiled from Mecca all the way to Medina for the cause of Allah. So whatever these Sahaba radiallahu anhum believed in, they believed in it with a true and sincere belief. So those mushrikeen, they realize if we go to Medina and we fight against Ahlul Medina, the people of Medina, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that what is going to cause us and what is that thing that is going to remain with us, that we are not now going to turn upon our heels and run away. What did they decide? That they were going to take their women folk with them. Because now they realize that if we now go out with our women folk and those Muslims, they defeat us, then our women folk are exposed. So they took their women folk to Medina along with them. So when the battle began, the mushrikeen, they left their women folk behind them, behind the rows of the mushrikeen. When the army of the mushrikeen was present, they left their women folk behind them under the guise that if the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, if those Muslims overpower us, then we will stand till the last man and we will not allow them to overcome us. Why? Because our women are behind us. How are we going to expose our women now to these Muslims? So then the battle began in earnest. When the battle began, the Muslims, alhamdulillah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them strength. And they began to overpower the enemy from the idol worshippers. So the battle reached a stage, remember, that the archers are still on the side of the hillock. On the side of that small mountain, the Sahaba, the archers are still there present and they're not moving from their position. Up until the Muslims began to overpower them. When they overpowered them, the mushrikeen, regardless of what pact they had made already in Mecca, they turned upon their heels and they began to flee. So the women, when they saw that their menfolk were coming towards them, they got up and they turned upon their heels and they fled also. So some of the Sahaba who were on the side of the mountain, some of the archers, they could see all of this taking place. Why? Because the hillock is not a huge, it's not a mountain in the sense of what we consider to be a mountain, it's a hillock. So they could see, they had a direct vision of what was taking place there. So then those archers, they saw that the mushrikeen, they had fled upon their heels, and their women folk behind them had stood, turned on their heels, and they had started fleeing. So one of the Sahaba who was an archer on the side of the mount, he said, "By Allah, we saw that the women, that they had raised their garments, and we could see their shins and their calves, and we could see the anklets that they were wearing," meaning the jewelry and the anklets upon their heels, "as they fled from the battlefield." So then some of us started saying to others, "Let us go down the booty. Let us go down and collect that which the mushrikeen have left behind." So some of us said to others, "Don't go. For indeed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us that regardless of what is taking place on the ground, you remain steady in your positions." So we are to obey Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So some of them, they made ijtihad. That they decided, no, we have won. So there's no point in remaining here now. So they came down from the mountain except for a very small number. Except for one and two, the rest of them, they came down from the mountain. When they came down from the mountain, unknown, unbeknown to the Muslims, that the mushrikeen had another contingency of warriors that were on the side of the mountain outside of the vision of the Muslims. And they were led by Khalid ibn Walid. So what did they do? They flanked the Muslims from one side of the mountain, so that then as the Muslims are fleeing behind the mushrikeen that had fled, they could flank the side of that hillock, come up behind the Muslims, and therefore on both the front and the back they are surrounded. So the Muslims now, they were trapped between the mushrikeen who were fleeing and the mushrikeen who were coming up behind them on horseback, led by Khalid ibn Walid. And as you know, Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu later became a Muslim, that he was from the greatest of the strategicians, of those who could devise a strategy in warfare. So then when they came up behind them, those mushrikeen that had fled, they turned around and they saw that now the Muslims, they have been blocked from behind and we are in front of them. So then the slaughtering began. 70 of the Sahaba, including Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, and likewise Mus'ab bin Umair, and other than them, that they were slaughtered at the battle of Uhud. They were killed at the battle of Uhud at the hands of the mushrikeen. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they targeted him. Now they knew that we have completely surrounded the Muslims. Let's get to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we kill him, then the Muslims, the Islam and their religion is finished. So they headed for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they defended him and they protected him. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, that him and Abu Bakr and Umar and the Sahaba, they found a route into Uhud and they went into the mountain passes. Then the mushrikeen, they came looking for them, but they couldn't find them. And they feared entering into the mountain because they didn't know the mountain passes. So then they called out. And they called out to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not respond. So who did they call out to thereafter? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Showing, of course, that even the mushrikeen knew the order of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, which was the best after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they called upon Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr did not respond. Then they called upon Umar. Showing that in this particular issue, that the aqeedah even of those mushrikeen is better than the aqeedah of the Shia. Because even the mushrikeen, they knew that after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is Abu Bakr then Umar. But the point being that those archers, they descended from the mountain. which led to 70 of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum being martyred at the Battle of Uhud. And they are known as the Shuhada of Uhud, even till this day, that it is mashru' and it is legislated to go, when you're in Medina, to go to Uhud, where the martyrs are, where they were buried, and to make dua for them, just like you would go to any other graveyard, and to make dua for them. But the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were shocked. They were surprised. They couldn't believe it. That here we are now at the Battle of Uhud, and only previously, the year before, year and a half before, that we had fought them at the Battle of Badr. At the Battle of Badr, that the Muslims were outnumbered. 300 Muslims and maybe 900 to over 1,000 of the mushrikeen at the Battle of Badr. The Muslims were not readily prepared for that battle, yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. 70 of the mushrikeen were killed at that battle. 70 were taken captive at the Battle of Badr. Yet now at this battle, meaning a year later, a year and a half later, here we have now a battle where the Muslims, they are prepared. Their strategy is ready. Yet at this battle, the Muslims are defeated. So the Sahaba, they kept asking, from where? Where did it come from? How come we are being defeated? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause us to be defeated? So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayah. أَوَلَمَّا أَسَابَتْكُمْ مُسِيبَةٌ قَدْ أَسَّبْتُمْ مِثْلَيْهَا قُلْتُمْ أَنَّا هَذَا. That when the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that Allah mentions here, that what is the matter with you? This is like a precursor to the ayah. What is the matter with you? When a single disaster strikes you, meaning you Muslims, when a single disaster strikes you, although you struck your enemies with something twice as great. Why is it twice as great? Allah is referring to the Battle of Badr. Because the Muslims struck against the mushrikeen at the Battle of Badr with twice the disaster that they incurred at Uhud. Why? Because when the Muslims fought at Badr, that they killed 70 mushrikeen. And then they took 70 captive. How many? 140. At the Battle of Uhud, 70 of the Muslims were killed. So here the Muslims were saying, look, they were asking themselves the question, how come at the Battle of Badr that we hit them with twice as much they hit us with at the Battle of Uhud? Yet we were prepared at Uhud. How come they were able to defeat us? قُلْتُمْ أَنَّا هَذَا. What is this? Where has this come from? قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. So Allah informs the Messenger of Allah, tell them, O Muhammad, it is from your own hands. It is from your own selves. It is what your own hands have earned. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful over everything. Meaning that Allah is the one who gave you victory at Badr. Because He was the all-powerful. And at the Battle of Uhud, Allah is the one that you were given this defeat at the Battle of Uhud. Because of what your own hands had earned. And indeed Allah is still all-powerful. Meaning that yes, Allah was powerful then and Allah is powerful now. For indeed Allah is all-powerful. Yet you were defeated. And this defeat is as a result of what your own hands earned. What did they do? What was the mistake they made at Uhud? That a group of the Muslims at the Battle of Uhud disobeyed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah here admonished them that this is from your own selves. That when the defeat comes upon a Muslim, he should look towards his own self. This is why when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he wrote to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, that the Muslims they were being, that they found that when they were entering into battle in the lands of Persia, that the Muslims they found that in a particular battle that they were not getting the upper hand against the enemy, against the mushrikeen. So Umar wrote to them. He said, don't look at the weaponry of the disbelievers. Don't look at the number of horses that they have or the number of camels and the number of spears and shields that they have. Rather look towards yourself. Look towards your own sins. Because indeed Allah gives victory to a qawm because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowing upon them the bounty of victory because of their piety. And this makes sense even in our times. What? The sunnah of Allah changes? Al-jaza min jinsil amal. This is a maxim that is that, that, That is something that continues up until the end of time. A principle, a fundamental. Al-jaza min jinsil amal. That the recompense is in accordance to the deed. You do good, then Allah will recompense you with good. If you do evil, then Allah will give you the result of the evil that you have done. إِذَا تَبَعَيَتُمْ بِالْعِينَةِ As Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you take part in interest transactions, وَأَخَذْتُمْ بِأَذْنَابِ الْبَقَرِ and you hold on to the tails of cattle. As Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying this, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ أَنِ الْهَوَى And he never spoke from his desires. إِذَا تَبَعَيَتُمْ بِالْعِينَةِ وَأَخَذْتُمْ بِأَذْنَابِ الْبَقَرِ وَرَدِيتُمْ بِالزَّرَعِ وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادِ صَلَّتَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ظُلَّ لَا يَنْزِعُهُ هَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioning a principle that is contained within this hadith, that if you take part in interest transactions and you hold on to the tails of cattle and you become satisfied with the cultivation of the earth, وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادِ and you abandon jihad, صَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ظُلَّ Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down upon you humiliation when you embark upon these sins and you abandon the obligations of Allah. Then Allah will send down upon you humiliation and Allah will not remove the humiliation حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ Up until you return back to your religion. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say up until you return back to fighting or to killing. He didn't say that. What did Allah say? Up until you return back to your Islam. So the issue is that when the humiliation comes upon a Muslim, it comes upon a Muslim because of his distance from Islam and he's drowning himself in sin. The more sin that you commit, the greater the humiliation. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came, He brought those people out of darkness by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into the light. Allahu waliyu alladhina amanu. That Allah is the wali of those who believe. Yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. And He brings them out of darkness into the light. Walladhina kafaru awliyahumu ash-shaytan. That as for those who disbelieve, أولياءهم الطاغوت نعم جزاك الله خير that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions والذين كفروا أولياءهم الطاغوت يخرجونهم من النور إلى الظلمات that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that as for those who disbelieve then their friends and protectors are the طاغوت They take them out of the light and bring them into darkness. So when we obey the taghut, which calls you to the shirk of Allah, to associate partners with Allah, to disobey Allah, and to transgress the bounds with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the job of these tawaghit and these false deities is to take you out of the dark, take you out of the nur, out of the light, into the darkness. Whereas what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did was to take them out of darkness and bring them into the light. And those are whom? Those are the believers. Because they are the ones who have iman. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he brought them out of darkness into the light. Out of the constriction of this dunya. Out of the tightness of this dunya. And he brought them into the vastness of this world and the vastness of the hereafter. These individuals who came out of the desert. These individuals who were fighting each other for decades over a donkey or a camel or a sheep. Tribe, killing tribe. From the people of Mecca and from the people of Medina. That they were enemies one to another. Then Allah brought their hearts together. This is as a consequence of them embracing the deen of Islam. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And being patient upon that. At the peak of the oppression of the Muslims in Mecca. Khabbab ibn Arat. That he came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith in Bukhari. whilst the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in the shade of the Kaaba, and he had wrapped around him his burda or his cloak. So he said to him, this Sahabi, he said, Ya Rasulullah, do you not see this heat and this pressure and this oppression that we are suffering? Will you not supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to this individual, to this Sahabi radiallahu anhu, Khabbab ibn Arad, he said to him that indeed that there used to be a people who came before you, that a man will be brought from one of them. Those who used to believe from the people who came before you, what is apparent as the scholars have mentioned, this is from the followers of a Nabi from the Bani Israel, meaning that he was a Muslim, a follower of one of the prophets that came before. That one of them will be brought forth and a pit would be dug for him, or a shallow would be dug for him out of the ground, and then he will be placed into it. That man will be placed into it. Then a saw will be placed upon the top of his head, and his body will be sawn into two pieces up until it separated. Yet that would still not cause him to leave his religion. And he will be brought, or someone will be brought, and a metal comb will be placed upon his body, and his skin and his veins would be torn from the skeleton of his body. Yet that would still not cause him to leave his religion. He would still not leave his religion. He would remain steadfast. This is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving his Sahaba radiallahu anhum tarbiyah, cultivating them with patience, steadfastness, and not despairing at that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for the believers. So a metal comb be placed upon that person, and it would that metal comb, they would use it to rip off the skin from his body, and that would not cause him to leave his religion. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, by Allah, this deen will be established. This religion will be established up until a man will travel from Sana'a to Hadramaut in Yemen, and he will not fear anything except Allah and then the wolf upon his sheep. But you are a hasty people. That you are musta'ajileen, that you are hasty, you want it now. Here the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is cultivating his Sahaba. First and foremost, that there is suffering that you will have to endure because of the harm that the enemy will bring upon you. But look at the context of the narration. The context of the narration is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in Mecca. He's sitting in the shade of the Kaaba whilst 360 idols are being worshipped around the Kaaba. People used to make tawaf around the house of Allah, the mushrikeen, naked, clapping and whistling as they're making tawaf. Idols that were worshipped, Allat, which was a sanctuary or a place near Taif, next to a, like a rock or a hilltop type of place. And it was Allat that it was named after a man who used to mix gruel for the pilgrims, because the mushrikeen used to perform hajj, because some of that which Ibrahim alayhi salam was upon remained up until the time of the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this man used to mix gruel for the pilgrims used to come to perform hajj. So when he died, they took him as an object of worship. His grave, next to his grave, they built a sanctuary, and they used to visit it, and they used to call upon him Allat, which is a deviation of the name of Allah, Allah. They made a feminine derivative of it, and they called it Allat. They used to worship Al-Uzza. Likewise, Al-Uzza near Taif, or between Mecca and Taif. That this was a sanctuary where they placed a place where they used to visit, and there used to be a devil in there, a female devil. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he sent Khalid ibn Walid to go out and destroy it. So he destroyed the sanctuary, the building itself. He chopped down the tree that was connected to it. And also he killed the woman who was naked, her hair was disheveled, and she was throwing dust upon her head, Khalid bin Walid said. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded him to kill her, or commanded him to destroy it. And he informed the Messenger of Allah, indeed I killed her. He said, the Messenger of Allah said, indeed you have killed that devil. You have killed her. So they used to worship. And they, obviously in the names of these idols, that, or in the names of these gods that they worship, they used to make figurines. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sitting in the shade of the Kaaba whilst all of this is taking place around him. The worship of idols, the worship of others besides Allah, the sanctuary that was built, this house of Allah, that was built for the purpose of the worship of Allah alone, centuries earlier, millennium earlier, by the like, by Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son, Ismail. They built it for the purpose of the worship of Allah at a time when it was desolate desert. And the prophets used to go there to perform Hajj. 70 prophets prayed in Masjid Khayf in Mina. 70 prophets. Prophets used to perform Hajj. Now it's in the hands of the mushrikeen. Is there a site in Islam more sacred than the Kaaba? Jerusalem? Medina? Is there anything more sacred than the Kaaba? Nothing, ya ikhwan. It is the haram before the haram in Medina. Just as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that Allah has made Medina a haram for me, just as he made Mecca a haram for Ibrahim. So the haram that was there previously was Mecca. And the prophets performed Hajj. It is from the pillars of Al-Islam to perform Hajj. Where do you perform Hajj? Mecca. Was there any other place that Hajj was performed? No. Mecca was the place of Hajj. Musa alayhi salam performed Hajj. 70 prophets prayed in Masjid Khayf in Mina. Yet now in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this sacred place is in the hands of the mushrikeen. And the Muslims are being oppressed and being killed and being tortured, boycotted. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the tribe of Banu Hashim was boycotted. No one was allowed to trade with them. After Islam began to take hold in Mecca, even though there weren't that many people who embraced Islam, not as much as it embraced Islam later in Medina, but nevertheless, it had begun to have an effect in Mecca. People were now talking about not worshipping the idols, that the idols should be destroyed, that only Allah is to be worshipped. This is the house that is built for the worship of Allah. Now people started saying that. So what did they do, the Quraysh? The Quraysh, they decided that any woman who wishes to marry them is not allowed to marry them. Marriage is not permitted with them. Also on top of that they are to be boycotted. No business is to be done with them. No one is allowed to talk to them. And then they were pushed to one side of Mecca. And they suffered in that time. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in that time, he went out to Taif to give them da'wah, to call them to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And they stoned him. The youth, they were gathered in Taif, and they were commanded to stone Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Only because he called them to the worship of Allah. And they threw rocks and stones at him, up until his body started bleeding. And his sandals were filled with the blood that was pouring from his body. Then as he left Taif, Jibreel came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, indeed Allah has sent to you an angel of the mountains. Whatever you command, it will do it for you. The angel will do that for you. So the angel said, command me and I will crush it. In some of the narrations that he was referring to Mecca. Command me and I will crush Mecca between its mountains and kill all of them. Look at the answer of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no, for indeed there may come out of them an offspring who will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he never gave up this desire, his nature of being merciful, a mercy to the whole of creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Merciful and being hopeful and being having this ardentness with him, this ardent desire that they should be guided. So he said no, even though they would have been destroyed at that word, because Allah had promised him that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But here the Messenger of Allah in the hadith of Khabbab ibn Arad, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informs him that there was a man who was brought before you, that a hole be dug for him, placed in the hole, and his body being sawn in two pieces, and he would not leave his religion. Why? Because of that person steadfastly holding on to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That a metal comb placed upon his body. So now the Sahabi and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu are pondering about their situation. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not leave him. He said to them, by Allah, this deen, this religion will be established. A man will travel from Sana'a to Hadramaut. Why Sana'a and Hadramaut? Don't think of Yemen and Sana'a and Hadramaut like you think of it today, a Muslim country. In those times, it was the land of Ahlul Kitab, the Christians predominantly. And the same land from where came Abraha, in the year of the birth of Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to come and destroy the Kaaba. So they were known for having strength. That very same land, in the year of my birth, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the year of my birth, that very same land where they came from Yemen all the way to Mecca to destroy the Kaaba, that very same land, that the Muslims, Islam will be established in that land. Don't worry, Islam will be established even in, you're worried about Mecca. You're worried about the oppression in Mecca, in this, his religion will be established. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could have said that this deen will be established up until a man will make tawaf around this house and he will not fear anybody except Allah. But yet the Messenger of Allah chose another country, Yemen. Sahaba thinking about Mecca. The Messenger of Allah has said, don't worry about Mecca, Yemen. Islam will reach Yemen. Yemen. Islam will reach Yemen, those Christians. You're worried about Mecca? Don't worry about Mecca. Islam will be established upon this earth. But don't be musta'ajileen. Don't be from those who are hasty and quick and you want it all in one go. Let Islam, let Iman take root in your hearts. Let it take root in your hearts. For indeed when Islam takes root in your hearts and Iman is established in your hearts, and you worship Allah, and you abandon the worship of the false deities, and you obey Allah, and you keep away from the disobedience of Allah, Allah will surely give you that establishment upon the ard. Allah will give it to you. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came, tasfiyah and tarbiyah, to purify them, to purify those people from the shirk that they were upon, the false practices that they were upon, burying their daughters alive in the desert. What kind of corruption were the corruption in terms of ibadah, which is of course worse than corruption in terms of sins, because they were offering worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet they did not regard those idols like al-Manat and al-Uzza and al-Lat. They didn't regard these idols to be creators of them. They didn't believe that al-Lat, this man who used to mix the gruel, Al-Uzza, they didn't regard them to be their creators. Rather, they knew that Allah was their creator. If you were to ask them, O Muhammad, who is the one who creates the heavens and the earth? To whom belongs the heavens and the earth and whatever is within them? Who is the one who sends down the rain? Who is the one who brings the dead back to who brings the living to brings death to the living and then brings life to the dead? Indeed, they will say, it is Allah. So they knew it was Allah who created them. But they believed that these idols that they were worshipping were intermediaries between them and Allah. هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاءُنَا إِنْدَ اللَّهِ. That these idols that we worship, that they are nothing but intercessors between us and Allah. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded to condemn them, and Allah condemned them for worshipping them whilst they know that Allah created them, what did they say? مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We don't worship them except that they bring us closer to Allah in worship. So they worship their idols, not believing that the idols created them or give life and give death. They believe that these idols were intercessors between them and Allah. Just like you find Muslims today who go to the graves of the dead. Go to the graves of Ali and Hussein, Ahmed al-Badawi, Abdul Qadir al-Jilani. Even to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they say that we don't believe that Muhammad created us. We're not stupid. Rather, we believe that Muhammad is an intercessor between us and Allah. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We don't worship them except they bring us closer to Allah in rank. That was the statement of the mushrikeen. Same as they used to say. We don't worship them except that they bring us closer to Allah. We don't worship Muhammad except that he brings us closer to Allah. He's a wasila to wassul. We are seeking nearness to Allah by calling upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or that we are seeking nearness to Allah by calling upon Ahmed al-Badawi in Egypt. They go to his shrine in Egypt. And when they are within 20 or 30 meters of the shrine, they take off their shoes. They say, no, this is sacred land. This is the grave of the Sheikh. So they take off their shoes before they even enter. Of who? Of the grave. Not the grave, the shrine of an individual. And then they go and they seek his aid and they seek his assistance. They're talking about establishing political power in Egypt. When are you going to establish Tawheed in Egypt? Fully and properly. Yes, there are Muwahideen there. From the people of Tawheed, from the people of Sunnah and Salafiyyah. So they're walking in the streets and marching because they want to remove this ruler and replace him with that one. Then 6 months later they want to remove him and replace him with that one. Then in another 6 months they want to change him and put him... What's this? Musical chairs? But the real core issue of the worship of Allah, they pay no attention to. When will they go to the graves and say, we want that we will spread dawah in this land so that people are upon Tawheed, so they don't worship the grave of Ahmed al-Badawi. Same in Pakistan, in Lahore and other places where they have shrines to the peers and to the saints. And they worship and they call upon them directly. Oh, so and so, ya Abdata, ya Abdul Qadir, ya Chisti, ya Khawaj. In East Africa, same thing, or West Africa, the Tijaniya, in the southern Russia, the former Russian republics, Uzbekistan, Azerbaijan, the Naqshbandiya, in Turkey, the Naqshbandiya, they call directly upon upon whom they regard to be the awliya of Allah. So what victory are they going to be given? That those individuals that they were killed, that the Prophet ﷺ referred to in the hadith of Khabbab ibn Arat, that those were believers who used to worship Allah steadfast upon their deen. And they were tortured and they wouldn't leave their religion. And Allah promised the Sahaba that the deen of Allah will be established. For whom? For those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Not associating partners with him. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. As Allah mentions in the Quran, in Surah An-Nur, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that this is a wa'ad from Allah. A wa'ad meaning a promise and a pledge from Allah for those of you who have iman. What is iman? Tawheed of Allah begins iman. The foundation of iman is the tawheed of Allah. The aqeedah which is sound. So Allah promises those who have iman. And the foundation of iman is this tawheed. Upon which everything in Islam is built is this tawheed. Of worshipping Allah alone. Not associating any partners with him. Not ascribing to anyone else the right that only belongs to Allah. Not believing in amulets. These things that the people hang around their necks. What they call the taweez. Or the amulets or the tamaim. And they say, this will protect me. My husband doesn't talk to me anymore. Don't worry, I'll write it. Put it around your neck. He'll talk to you next week. Just give me £60. Go back next week. I gave you £60 last week. It didn't work. You need to give another £60 because it wasn't strong enough. I'll make it stronger. Another £60. Someone falls ill, wrap the tamaim, wrap the tamima, this amulet around your arm. I'll write some numbers and letters for you, maybe some ayat, backwards or straight, or whichever way they want to write them. Put it around your neck, put it around your arm, and it will protect you. If it doesn't help out because your iman is weak, you have to believe in me more. Another £60. So they hang these around their necks, believing that these are the things that will protect them and aid them. Whereas in their salah they say, yet they don't realize what they're saying in the salah. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Only you do we worship, O Allah. And only your isti'ana do we seek. Only your worship, only your aid do we seek. This is what we say every time we recite the Quran. Yet when the problem comes, let's look for the nearest peer or the nearest saint or the nearest Mawlana or Mawlahum. Let's look for the one who will aid us and help us. Write down something, give him a tenner. Then, you know, just like the Christians with the Catholics. No, ya ikhwan, this will not bring victory. When the Messenger of Allah said what he said to Khabbab ibn Arat, he said what he said to those who have iman and they believe. A pledge from your Lord, a wa'ad from your Lord for those of you who have iman, meaning that you begin with the asl of Tawheed, worshipping Allah alone. Not that you go to fortune tellers, giving the right of the unseen and the knowledge of the future to a fortune teller. So you go to some gypsy or to some caravan that's parked in town center and you pay some money so she can read your palm or read a crystal ball. And all it is devils whispering to her and the shayateen are whispering to her or to him. Or that you go to your astrology page and you say, well, which star sign am I? Let me just figure out which year I was born. And you figure out which star sign you are. Right? And then they tell you, okay, tomorrow you're going to meet so-and-so, and then you're going to lose money, and then you're going to gain money. And every Muslim's reading this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whomsoever visits a fortune teller or a soothsayer, then his prayer is not accepted for 40 days. So now when you open it up, that magazine or that newspaper, and you read that star sign, I'm Sagittarius or I'm Libra or I'm Virgo or whatever, and you think it's fun, it's not fun. It violates your Tawheed. Who has knowledge of the unseen and the knowledge of the future and knowledge of the hour? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't know what's going to come to you tomorrow by way of rizq. Only Allah knows, because He wrote it in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that 50,000 years before creation, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the qalam, created the pen. Then He said to the pen, uktub, write. The pen said, what shall I write? Allah said, write everything that will occur till yawm al-qiyamah. And that book is with Allah, as in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had written the affair of the whole of creation, the decree of the whole of creation, then He ascended over His throne with the book. And then He wrote that indeed my mercy has overcome my anger. It's in the book, ya ikhwan, my brothers and sisters. So now you go to the fortune teller. Allah has not given this knowledge to anybody else, except by way of revelation. To the Messenger of Allah, He gave some knowledge of the unseen, that there will come the Dajjal, that there will come Juj wa Majuj, and that there will come the Gog and Magog, that the sun will rise from the west, and so on and so forth. The Prophet ﷺ was given that knowledge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when Jibreel asked him, when he said to the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, when he came in the form of a man, to the Messenger of Allah, in the Masjid al-Nabawi, in Medina, and he sat next to the Messenger of Allah, and the Sahaba, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab said, that a man, that on that day we were sitting amongst with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, baynama nahnu julusu inda rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when we were sitting with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a man came in. He had exceedingly black hair and exceedingly white clothes, and he sat next to the Messenger of Allah, putting his knees next to the knees of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, putting his hands upon the thighs of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said to the Messenger of Allah, he said, ya Muhammad, akhbirni anil Islam. He said, oh Muhammad, tell me about Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ told him that Islam is to testify that there is nothing worthy of worship except for Allah, and that Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah, and to establish the prayer, and to give the zakat, and to pay, and to fast the month of Ramadan, and to perform hajj for the one who is able to do so, for whom the path has been made easy to do so. Then he said, sadaqt. He said, you have spoken the truth. Umar said, we were amazed. Here's a man coming out of nowhere. We don't know who he is. There's no signs of journeying upon him. And he asked the Messenger of Allah a question. And then he says, you have spoken the truth. So that surprised the Sahaba. Then he said, أخبرني عن الإيمان. He said, inform me about Iman. So the Prophet ﷺ said that Iman is to believe in Allah, to believe in the angels, to believe in the books, to believe in the messengers, to believe in the last day, and to believe in the pre-decree, it's good and it's evil. He said, Sadaqt. He said, you have spoken the truth. So then he said, أخبرني عن الإحسان. Inform me about Ihsan, perfection in worship. He said, then Ihsan is to worship Allah. كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ, as if you see him, though you see him not. فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ, for indeed he sees you. So in all of this, look, at the end of that he said, then tell me about the hour. Now he's asking him, when is the hour? And he said, the one who is being asked knows no more than the one who is asking. I don't know. Doesn't know the hour. No one knows. Yet when we go to the fortune teller, or when people go to the fortune teller, that these individuals are violating their tawheed. As the Prophet ﷺ said, that whomsoever goes to the fortune teller or the soothsayer and believes in what he has said, then he has disbelieved in what Muhammad has brought. This is tawheed. Violation of tawheed. We want victory, we want everything, yet how many people are following these fundamentals of al-Islam? They think tawheed is just to say, La ilaha illallah. Khalas. That's tawheed. Or to learn its translation. They don't know its meaning. They don't know the meaning of the kalimat to tawheed. The meaning of these words they don't know. They don't know its conditions. They don't know the levels of tawheed, the types of tawheed, the categories of tawheed. Yet they want the victory to come. When Khabbab ibn Arad went to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that state, they were more deserving than we are today. They were more deserving. Yet the Messenger commanded them with sabr. And they were patient. And Allah gave them Medina. And Allah commanded the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca to make jihad. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded by Allah in Mecca to make jihad. وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا. In Mecca this ayah was revealed, as Ibn Qayyim mentions. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, make jihad against them with it, the greater jihad. Yet, when we look at the Meccan period of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, not once was the sword raised, nor a spear thrown, nor an assassination took place. Never once. Whilst 360 idols were being worshipped, not one protest. Meaning that none of the Sahaba went out rallying and marching in the streets with banners like you find these people today. At the drop of a hat, the price of bread goes up 5 pence and they're marching in the streets. See, that's what they do in our times. The ruler goes and visits. The United States of America, you see marching, people marching in the home countries. So the Egyptian ruler goes to Washington. Khalas, excuse for them to march. Why is he gone to America? Who are you? You find people, why? Because the people today are not following the sunnah of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they want what those Sahaba had. When did the Sahaba ever, who had more right? If you're talking about the right to go out and march, which is not an Islamic right, because we Muslims don't go out and march, because it's not from the sunnah. Sahaba didn't do it. But if anyone did have the right to march, who would have the greater right? The ones who are living in a town where 360 idols are being worshipped around the most sacred site in Islam? And people are making tawaf around the Kaaba naked, even women? Women used to make tawaf around the house of Allah naked in the time of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the hands of the mushrikeen, when the mushrikeen had power over Mecca. Yet no sahaba, none of the sahaba radiallahu anhum, went marching or protesting in the streets. None of them. Not against Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Abu Sufyan, none of them. Why? That's the question. Why wouldn't they? What, Cairo is more important than Mecca? These countries are more important. Bahrain is more important than Mecca. And the rulers of Egypt and the rulers of Bahrain are worse than Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. Because they were in charge. Yet the Prophet ﷺ didn't do it. The Sahaba didn't do it. Allah didn't command them to do it. Yet Allah commanded them with jihad. What jihad was He commanding with then? Ibn Qayyim mentions this was the jihad of the Quran. The jihad of the kalima la ilaha illallah. To spread the word of Islam, to teach the people Tawheed, to purify them from the shirk and the idolatry that they were drowned in. This is the solution, this is the cure. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the ayah, going back to the ayah, a pledge from your Lord for those of you who believe and they work righteous deeds. And they work righteous deeds. These righteous deeds, what are they? These are righteous deeds of obedience. Obedience of the heart. Obedience of the tongue. And obedience of the limbs. This is what it means. That we are obedient to Allah. And we obey Allah. And we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala internally and externally. Whether we are alone or whether we are in public. That we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we work righteous deeds. You give in charity. You are good to your neighbor. You establish the prayer. You give the zakat. You obey the ruler. You are good to your parents. You give good tarbiyah to your children. You recite the book of Allah. You make the dhikr of Allah. You don't involve yourself in bid'ah or innovations that the Prophet ﷺ and his sahaba were not upon. Righteous deeds. You establish the tahajjud prayer. You pray the sunnah al-rawatib. The sunnah prayers that are connected to the salah. You pray the duha prayer. You fast the month of Ramadan. You perform hajj. How many people, even with regard to hajj, how many people have the ability financially to perform hajj, yet they delay it and delay it and delay it? Why? Because they don't have that attachment. They want politics. They want to march. They want to speak against this ruler and that ruler. They want to speak about the state of the ummah. Yet when Allah gives them the ability to perform a pillar of al-Islam, they don't go and perform it. Can't be bothered. I'll wait till I'm 65. I'll wait till then. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that indeed Allah said that what is wrong with my servant? That I have given him health and I have given him wealth, yet he does not perform hajj at least once every 5 years. I have given him health and he does not visit my house at least once every 5 years. What is wrong with him? Meaning that if Allah has given you health and Allah has given you property and wealth, Allah has not made your affairs straightened and difficult. How many people are there who are wealthy and there is nothing wrong with their bodies and their limbs, yet they delay and delay and delay hajj? But as soon as they see something on telly, they say, yes, we should go out and march and we should support their marching and we should do this and we should do that. Yet the basics in Islam that they are able to do, they don't do. They want to take on the role of the ruler. They want to now involve themselves in politics. Well, I think the ruler should do this. And I think the ruler should do that. And I think they want to now play the role of the ruler. The armchair critic. But that which Allah has obligated upon him, they don't want to do that. Why? Because that now means spending some wealth. It means going and facing some heat of the sun. It means going to Arafah dusty and disheveled. Who's going to do that? Who's going to spend their wealth and do that? Because that is ibadah. Who is going to now stand in Arafah on that day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the nearest heaven and he boasts in front of his angels that they have come dusty and disheveled on that day of Arafah, dusty and disheveled. And then Allah says to his angels, Ya malaikati, oh my angels, bear witness that I have forgiven them. On the day of Arafah. We have the ability, we have the health, but we want to wait till we are in a walking stick or in a wheelchair so that someone can push us to Arafah. Why? Because that's what the deen has become to many of the people. So Allah has promised for those who believe and work righteous deeds that Allah will establish them in the earth. That Allah will give them khilafah in the earth. Just as He gave it to those who came before them. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. So here Allah mentions a promise from your Lord for those amongst you who believe and work righteous deeds, that Allah will establish them. That Allah will establish them in the earth just as He established those who came before them. And Allah will make them steadfast, or give them the establishment upon the deen that Allah is pleased with. And Allah will remove them from the state of fear in which they were in, and give them a state of security. يَعْبُدُونَنِي, so long as they worship me alone. And they do not associate any partners with me. And whomsoever disbelieves after that, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Then whomsoever disbelieves after that, then they are the fasiqun. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what you have to do. Iman, Tawheed, Aqeedah. Believe in Allah as He deserves to be believed, as He has commanded you to believe in Him. So your Aqeedah is sound and correct. Your belief in Allah is sound and correct as it should be, without any violation of Shirk and Tawheed. With any violation of Shirk upon the Tawheed, rather. That you believe in the angels as they are, that you have been commanded to believe in them. Likewise in the books, in the messengers, that you don't worship them. Rather you follow them as they are, as Allah has commanded you to follow them, with the finality of them being Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose message abrogated all of the messages that came before. To believe in the last day, Qiyamatul Sughra and Qiyamatul Kubra, the lesser day of judgment and the greater day of judgment, meaning the punishment of the grave and the reward in the grave and the questioning of the grave, which is known as the Qiyamah al-Sughra, the lesser day, or the lesser standing and judgment, or the lesser resurrection, and the greater resurrection in the Akhirah. The greater resurrection, when you will be questioned and your deeds will be weighed. So Allah has promised for those who believe and work righteous deeds that Allah will establish them, just as He established those who came before them. And then Allah mentions that He will establish for them their deen. Who will do all of this? Allah will do all of this. When the humiliation comes, who will send down the humiliation? Allah will send down the humiliation, as we mentioned in the hadith that came before. You want good, and you want khair. You want that goodness to come to the Muslims. Then the Muslims need to start acting, learning, acting upon their deen, learning their deen. Abandonment of shirk and kufr and bid'ah in all of its forms. Yes, bid'ah. And they say, oh, this is the slogan of the Salafi bid'ah. Yes, because we are against bid'ah. We are against all innovations that oppose that which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought. This religion is complete. It doesn't require anyone's addition. The religion that is perfect and complete, about which Allah's Messenger sallallahu Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Al-yawma ya'isa alladhina kafaru min dinikum." On this day Allah said, indeed the disbelievers have despaired in your religion. The unbelievers, they have despaired in your religion, O Muhammad. And then Allah mentions, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-islam deena. This day I have perfected for you your religion, perfected my favor upon you, and I'm pleased with Islam as your religion. Perfect religion. Who would want to come and add? They say, no, no, we can do more, we can do more. What do you want to do? We want to do the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You want to do more than the Sahaba did? Allah said this religion is complete, so where did the birthday come from? They say, oh, this is more completion. What? Abu Bakr didn't know? Abu Bakr didn't want to complete this completion? Didn't want to do more? So why didn't Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why didn't Abu Hurairah ibn Mas'ud, Sahaba, 114,000 of them at the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not one of them celebrated the birthday? But you want to celebrate the birthday, but you want victory as well. How is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do you expect the aid of Allah, the support of Allah, the nusr of Allah, the aid of Allah to come to you, whilst you are not following the commandment of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul. How many times Allah mentions this in the Quran? Obey Allah and obey the Messenger. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. Let those beware who oppose the command of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَلِيمٌ. That they may come upon them. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَلِيمٌ. that let those beware. Oh, yusibahum adhabun alim. No. Let those beware who oppose the command of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that lest some fitna be inflicted, fitna comes upon them, a tribulation comes upon them, or a painful torment be inflicted upon them. Why? Because they oppose the Messenger of Allah. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ رَسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَسِيرًا. That whomsoever opposes and contradicts the Messenger, are they not contradicting the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Those who partake in bid'ah, and they go and venerate the graves, and they embark upon a journey to go to the graves. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it is not permitted for an individual to embark upon a journey except to the three masajid. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he gave a fatwa that those who embark upon a journey to the graves of the awliya, to the graves of the saints, that they are sinful and they have innovated into the deen of Allah, because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not permit and he did not legislate the embarking upon a journey except to the three mosques. How many graves do you see in the world where the people have built mausoleums and structures over the graves and domes over the graves, and then they visit the graves and they charge the people entry to visit those graves, and they call upon the dead in those graves? Whereas the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, may the curse of Allah be upon the Jews and the Christians. For indeed, when a prophet or a righteous man used to die from amongst them, they used to take his grave as a place of worship. So, and likewise in the hadith upon the deathbed of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were sitting around him. And some of the wives were saying to the other wives that we migrated in the first migration to Abyssinia. And when we were in Abyssinia, we entered a church. And in the church, we saw that there were images on the walls of individuals, of their prophets and their righteous men. So the Prophet ﷺ was upon his deathbed, coming in and out of consciousness. So the Prophet ﷺ heard what they said. He said, yes, indeed. For indeed, when the righteous and the prophets used to die from amongst the Jews and the Christians, they used to make images of them inside of their places of worship. And by Allah, they will be the most severely punished Yawm al-Qiyamah. Most severely punished. So the introduction of graves into the masajid, because the Prophet ﷺ said that they took their graves as places of worship. They took their graves as masajid. So they took them as mosques, building mosques over them, or putting the graves inside of mosques. Like you find, for example, the founder of Jamaat al-Tabligh. May Allah guide them, this Jama'ah, the Tablighi Jamaat, or Jamaat al-Tabligh. You find them, that their founder, Muhammad Ilyas Kandahlawi. This Jama'ah began in the 1920s. It was never known before that time. So that's the first problem with it, that we have. How can you follow anything that only turned up the other day? Turned up yesterday in the 1920s? Whereas we are calling to the way of the Sahaba. So he wrote a book. They have a book, Fadailul A'mal. In this book, they have all types of shirk and kufr. You say shirk and kufr? Yes, shirk and kufr. An incident occurs inside of this book where they wrote it in this book. In the chapter of what they call the chapter of Durood, which is sending, as they claim, sending the salah and the salam upon the Messenger of Allah. They said that there was a youth with his mother next to the Kaaba. Of course, this is after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, my mother was very ill, and her belly began to swell and her body began to swell because of this illness. So I was thinking, what shall I do? He said, I looked into the sky and I saw a cloud. Standing on the cloud was a man. Then the cloud, it descended. Then and that individual, he stepped off the cloud and he came to me. I said to him, who are you? He said, I am Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that he stroked my mother's face and her belly. He stroked my mother's face and her belly, and she was cured. And then he said, send the salah and salam upon me. Send the salutations of peace and blessings upon me. And then he went. If this is not shirk, if this is not a violation of the tawheed of Allah, then what is it? First of all, the Prophet ﷺ never touched a foreign woman when he was alive, ever. In fact, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, I do not touch foreign women. I don't touch women that are not related to me intimately, meaning either my wife or my daughter, I don't touch them. But he comes back after his death because your mother's sick and he strokes her belly and they put this in their book. The Prophet ﷺ did not come down for Abu Bakr. The Prophet ﷺ did not come off a cloud for Umar when Umar was stabbed in the Masjid al-Nabawi. Yet the Prophet ﷺ did not come down from the cloud. When Ali radiallahu anhu was struck with the sword of a Khariji, by the sword of an insurgent, the Prophet ﷺ did not come down from the cloud. But for your mother, he came down and he touched a woman that is not related to him. This is Jamaat al-Tabligh. Anyway, Muhammad Ilyas, a Kandahlawi, that when he died, they put his grave inside of their masjid. Inside of their masjid. This is Tawheed. Whereas the ulama are agreed by ijma that it is not permissible to pray in a mosque where there is a grave. You may say, but akhi, what about the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is that not in the masjid? It is not in the masjid. Where did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam die? Whose house? Aisha. Was that a masjid or a house? House. It wasn't a masjid. So the first thing is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died in the house. Did they take his body outside of the house and bury him under the minbar? No. Did they take his body outside of the house of Aisha and put him in the masjid? No one did it from the Sahaba. And there were over 100,000 Sahaba alive at the time. Not a single one of them even suggested it. Because as he was dying, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, may the curse of Allah be upon the Jews and Christians. For when a prophet used to die from amongst them, they used to take his grave as a masjid. So the prophets of the Sahaba, they knew we're not supposed to do this, so they didn't do this. Secondly, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that indeed a prophet is buried wherever he dies. So they buried him where he died. Aisha said that he died in my lap. That's where he died, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he died in the house of Aisha, then he was buried in the house of Aisha. When Abu Bakr died, he was buried next to him. When Umar died, he was buried next to him. So all three of them were buried together in the apartment of Aisha radiallahu anha. This apartment had four walls surrounding it. Ibn Qayyim said 7 centuries later that indeed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was buried in the house of Aisha, and that house was surrounded by four walls, and those four walls remain. So when the expansion of the Masjid al-Nabawi took place, it took place around the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Till this day, the scholars do not regard, the scholars of the Arabian Peninsula, the scholars of Riyadh and Mecca and Medina, they do not regard the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam till this day to be inside the masjid. They still see it as being isolated from the masjid by its four walls, because those four walls inside of them is what? The house of whom? Aisha radiallahu anha. This is a far cry from taking the body of a dead person and putting it inside of the masjid. This is Jamaat al-Tabligh. You want victory for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Then return back to the way of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Go back to their way, go back to their path, do what they did and keep away from what they kept away from. This is what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to do. كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِهِ وَآيَاتِنَا وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the purpose of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just as we have sent amongst you a messenger from your own selves, he recites upon you our verses. وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ, and he purifies you. From what? From all corruption. corrupt practices, corrupt worship, worship of other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ So He purifies you from shirk and false practices. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ And He teaches you the book and the hikmah. What's the hikmah? What's the hikmah? Sunnah. Imam Shafi'i said that I met such and such a number of my sheikhs. Imam Shafi'i died in the year 204. Every single one of them said, the hikmah, it is the sunnah. يُعَلِّمُكُمْ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ He teaches you the kitab, the Quran, and the hikmah, meaning the sunnah. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ مَا لَمْ تَكُونُ تَعْلَمُونَ And He teaches you that which you did not used to know. So the Messenger of Allah came to cultivate them, purify them, from shirk and from kufr and false acts of worship, to bring them upon the right path, to teach them the kitab, to cultivate them upon the book of Allah. And this is what Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, from the great scholars of this time, he said when he talked about the issue of tasfiyah and tarbiyah. He said tasfiyah, which is to purify, as you can see that there was the that was what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. Purify in these times, or in any time, it is. And he said that success will not be attained in the Ummah except by way of this. Purify from shirk, the worship of others besides Allah, major and minor. To purify from kufr, those acts of disbelief that the Muslims they fall into and they don't consider. Whether it be magic, whether it be fortune telling, or other than that from the affairs. That they purify themselves from innovations that have crept into Islam that ruin the pristine, or that they pollute the pristine Islam that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with false practices. Whether it be counting stones, the false practices that take place after the janaiz, after the death of a person, or after the janaza, or whether the false practices related to marriage, related to death, related to salah, related to fasting. All types of false practices that are innovations in the deen of Islam. That a person regards them to be Islam and they are nothing to do with Islam. To purify the religion from those false practices. To purify the religion from fabrications that have been ascribed to it, from fabricated hadith. Hadith that they say the Prophet ﷺ said, when you go back, the Prophet ﷺ never said it. And weak hadith, like the practices of Jamaatul Tabligh, and the Brelwis and the Sufis and the Naqshbandis and other than them. Fabricated and weak hadith that have no basis. And likewise, the tafasir, the tafsir or the explanations of the Quran that the people they write from their own minds and their own ideas. That do not take from the kitab and the sunnah and the way of the sahaba. That the tafsir of Sayyid Qutb, or the tafsir of al-Mawdudi, or the tafsir of Ahmed Riza Khan al-Brelwi. These tafasir and these types of so-called commentaries of the Quran, that they are far away from the tafsir and from the understanding of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And likewise, all types of ideas and ideologies that are people ascribe to Islam that are alien to Islam. So you purify the religion from that. Imagine a group of people who are no longer upon that. Then what remains? What remains is the kitab and the sunnah. The book and the sunnah, upon the understanding and the fahm of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Following the deen upon the way of the Sahaba. As-sabiqoon al-awwaloon min al-muhajirin wal-ansar. Min al-muhajirin wal-ansar wal-ladhin attaba'uhum bi-ihsan. That the best, or the first and foremost to believe from the muhajirin, from the ansar, and then those who follow them precisely. Allah is pleased with them, or those who follow them precisely radiallahu anhum, Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Him. Following the way of the Sahaba. So a person now is upon that deen. Then he cultivates the next generation upon that. This is what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Purified them from their false practices. Then cultivated them. وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ That He will teach you the kitab and the hikmah. Now the cultivation. Cultivate them upon the commands of Allah. Not being disobedient to Allah. Praying at the earliest time. How to pray. Praying properly. Keeping away from sin. Being obedient to Allah, cultivating your children upon that, reciting the Quran, reading the Quran, making dhikr of Allah, cultivating a whole generation upon this pristine Islam. Then that which came to the Sahaba will come to this Ummah. The more distant you are, the more distant that goodness and that bounty will be from Allah. Barakallahu feekum, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa jazakumullahu.